One of the things that I want to bring to this discussion is also an understanding of what's happened in the past. So before I was a socialist activist, I was a climate scientist. I studied marine sediments and the fossils that collect there to understand past ocean history. So I want to start my talk by introducing you all to a catastrophic event that took place on the Earth around 12,000 years ago. At that time, the Earth was just coming out of its last ice age. An increasing amount of solar radiation was pouring into the Northern Hemisphere, and atmospheric greenhouse gases were rapidly increasing. Massive ice sheets that had grown over North America and Scandinavia during the preceding 100,000 years were receding rapidly, raising global sea level by hundreds of meters. Then all of a sudden, Europe was plunged back into an ice age. In the course of 2 to 3 decades, so very, very rapid, temperatures plummeted, sea ice expanded, and mountain glaciers started to grow again. The frigid conditions would persist on the Earth for another 1,300 years before warming resumed and the Earth fully emerged from the last ice age. Now, this event was first discovered by scientists looking at lake sediments. They found the fossil remains of an Arctic flower had come back again. But over time, it was actually discoveries made by scientists examining marine fossils from deep ocean sediments that helped us to better understand what likely took place. And what they found was the main cause of this abrupt climate event was the Earth getting warmer. Now, how can that be? Like, how can warming trigger a return to an ice age climate? Well, 71% of the planet is covered by ocean. So the ocean is key to regulating our climate. If you disrupt the ocean, you disrupt the climate. And that's because ocean moves heat around the Earth by major currents. Warm water on the surface flows from the tropics to the north where it cools. It gives off heat to Europe and then it sinks to form a deep water cold current. And this warm current is connected to the cold current like a big conveyor belt. And essentially, this conveyor belt system is how heat is transported around the Earth. So when the Earth was warming, starting around 15,000 years ago, fresh water was pouring off the land from melting ice sheets and glaciers and into the ocean, right where the deep cold current forms. And you remember, the saltier the water, the heavier. So the fresh water pouring in made the water too light to sink. And that shut down the conveyor belt and stopped the heat transport system. And this meant that heat from the tropics was no longer being moved north and a return to ice age climate. Now, after thousands of years, or about 1,000 years or so, the circulation began again. And we fully emerged from the ice age to the Holocene conditions of today. These are the conditions in which civilization was developed, in which countless cultures have been created. These are the conditions in which humans cultivated plants and animals for food and for power. I think we all understand that the relatively stable climate and ecosystems that developed over the last 10,000 years are gone. Year after year after year, more and more oil and gas is being dug up and burned, trapping more and more heat and fueling a torrent of extreme weather events. And once again, as the Earth is warming rapidly, the ice sheets are melting. Fresh water is pouring into the North Atlantic. Scientists are telling us that they're already seeing signs that the ocean's conveyor belt is slowing. New research suggests that the ocean conveyor belt could be shut down, like it was in the past, within the next few decades. Now, this wouldn't plunge us into an ice age because the conditions are just very different this time, but it would have catastrophic consequences for everybody on the Earth. Europe would become cooler, but the tropics and the whole of the Southern Hemisphere where you all live would get hotter. And the areas where it's too hot to live and work would expand. It would also shift the major rain belts and affect the monsoons. And that means the most important impact on all of us, on everybody on the Earth, would be on our food system. So over the last 50 years, agribusiness and big food corporations have molded our food system from what we eat, which is increasingly the global standard diet, whereby just four crops, wheat, rice, corn, and soy, account for almost 60% of the calories grown by farmers, to how people, you know, access or even think about their food. And this means that locally, we have more diverse food, but globally, we do not. And crucially, that means that our food system is extremely vulnerable to shocks. As George Monbiot wrote in his recent book, Regenesis, which I do recommend reading, the global standard diet creates the global standard farm. And these farms are not only at risk of harvest failures, they are also monoculture dead zones for wildlife. Agriculture, not climate change, is the biggest driver of wildlife population declines and species extinction, better known as the biodiversity crisis. And that's because, firstly, their expansion has meant deforestation and destruction of ecosystems, but also year after year after year, they use huge amounts of inputs, fertilizers and pesticides that destroy the soil ecosystem, pollute our rivers and lakes, and create massive dead zones in coastal waters. These farms are also highly irrigated and are powered and fed by fossil fuels. And despite the promoted image of this small family farm, the vast majority of farms, over 70% of them, are owned or controlled by just 1% of farmers, which include investment banks, pension funds, hedge funds, and private equity vehicles. And of course, these farmers are not and never have been interested in producing nutritious food. They are interested in producing profits. So in the face of these compounding risks of abrupt climate change, of major disruptions to our food system, what has been the response of capital and governments? After decades of dragging their feet, they accept the science of climate change and biodiversity loss. But their solution, of course, is the market. We must tax ordinary people, charge them for driving their cars, tell them to stop using straws and paper cups, recycle more. They must change, not the big oil companies who are actually burning our future, nor the big tech companies building data center after data center, driving up energy needs and making it harder for us to transition to renewables. And for the actual small farmers who are already facing extreme weather events and reduced crop yields, who already don't make enough to get by, they have to change. Not the big meat processing plants and grocery store giants that set the prices. And this approach to climate and biodiversity action, which says that ordinary people's lives must radically change, that you must change your life while the system causing the crisis, capitalism, is maintained. This has fueled a new climate denialism and pushed a section of people towards the far right and fascist parties. In the recent European elections, the far right finished first in France, Italy, and Austria, and came second in Germany and the Netherlands. In Ireland, the far right got into local councils for the first time, and a far right populist candidate gained a European seat for the first time. And all of this, the risk of climate tipping points, of species extinction, of more violence, death, and destruction, of the rise of the far right and fascism again, pushing back women's rights and gains for the LGBTQ community, this will only continue as long as this system is in place. Capitalism cannot get us out because capitalism equals barbarism. We and our life support systems are being sacrificed on the altar of profits for the very, very wealthy, not us. We don't benefit. So it begs the question, what should we do in the face of all of that? I think strategically, we need to place an understanding of the ecological crisis at the center of what we're doing. We are not just eco-socialists when we are campaigning about the environment and socialists the rest of the time. We are eco-socialists when we are trade unionists and housing activists. Within the trade union movement, we are the people saying the ecological crisis is a workers' issue and we need to be involved. Within the environmental movement, we are the ones pointing to the power of the organized working class and the need for system change to be eco-socialist change. Programmatically, we need to reject any promotion of growth as the answer to the crises that the majority of people on this earth face. Instead, we have to recognize that in order to sustain a livable future for humanity and for a just transition for all, the workers, small farmers, and indigenous peoples in the global south, as well as in the advanced capitalist countries, it is necessary to reduce the total energy consumption and raw materials. And that's for two reasons. Firstly, to quicken the transition to 100% renewable energy. And secondly, to avoid further breaches of the other planetary boundaries. We can't allow more and more extraction of minerals like copper, cobalt, lithium from the global south to make more and more cars for the rich countries while their local environments and their communities are devastated. And that means that we have to degrowth to zero of energy usage on the military and advertising, drastic reductions in the incredible, disgusting consumption of the super rich with bans on private jets and yachts, to allow growth in energy usage of peoples in the global south within the planetary boundaries. It means advocating for a good life for every person on the planet. And that does not mean a superabundance of material private goods. Instead, we want high quality public goods, the decommodification of the commons and all aspects of life, and the healing of the rift between humanity and nature, an emphasis on being rather than having. We want mass retrofitting of people's homes to reduce energy consumption. We want investment in green jobs, including so-called care jobs in childcare, education, and healthcare. We want free, green, and frequent public transport, getting people out of private cars. We want universal basic services, a banning of planned obsolescence, and a enshrining of right to repair of all consumer goods. We need an agricultural model ensuring the right to decent income for all farmers while shifting away from high energy intensive beef and dairy farming to low energy regenerative farming. We want a 4-day week without loss of pay, and crucially, a democratically planned economy so that we can collectively make the choice on what to spend our energy and resources on. At the beginning of the First World War, over 100 years ago, the revolutionary socialist Rosa Luxemburg, who was campaigning against that war, declared that, quote, "Today we face the choice, either the triumph of imperialism and the collapse of all civilization as in ancient Rome, depopulation, desolation, degeneration, a great cemetery, or the victory of socialism." That means the conscious, active struggle of the international working class against imperialism and its method of war. Today, more than 100 years later, the choice is the same. Eco-socialism, a socialism that centers the ecological crises, or barbarism. We have a choice here. The climate has changed, but every tenth of a degree it increases matters. Every ecosystem matters, and of course, every human life matters. We do not have to accept this rotten system which threatens everything we hold dear. We have to build the conscious, active struggle of the international working class against imperialism to stop the destruction, to save as much as we can, but not just to defend. We must also go on the offense to build a movement, not just to tear down this system, but to build another world, an eco-socialist world.